Schubert, played by a girl in an exquisite dress, candles and chandeliers sparkling in her hair and eyes. Art. Surface, of course, but art is all surface and symbol at once. Those who go beneath the surface do so at their peril. You remember Basil Hallward, the painter whose disappearance some years ago caused such public excitement and conjecture? He it was who painted that picture. That notorious picture.
The Picture of Dorian Gray by Oscar Wilde. Dramatised for radio by Nick McCarty. With Jamie Glover as Dorian Gray and Ian MacDiarmid as Lord Henry Wotton.
I was in the habit then of visiting Basil's studio regularly. It was summer, and the studio was filled with the rich odour of roses. When the summer breeze stirred the trees of the garden, there came through the open door the heavy scent of lilac, or the delicate perfume of the pink flowering thorn.
Well, Henry, what do you think of it?
I was lying on the divan of Persian saddlebags, smoking an opium-tinted cigarette, and watching the play of light through the long tussore silk curtains that were stretched in front of the large window. The dim roar of London was like the bourdon note of a distant organ.
Well?
It is quite the best thing you have done.
I believe it is.
Who is the young man? A model?
No.
He is quite beautiful. You have captured more than a likeness.
You must send it next year to the Grosvenor.
Why not the Academy?
The Academy is too large and vulgar. Whenever I go there, there have been either so many people that I've not been able to see the pictures, which was dreadful, or so many pictures that I've not been able to see the people, which was worse.
I won't send it anywhere.
What odd chaps you painters are. You do anything to gain a reputation. As soon as you have one, you seem to want to throw it away. It's silly of you, for there is only one thing in the world worse than being talked about, and that is not being talked about.
I know you'll laugh at me, but I really can't exhibit it. I've put too much of myself into it. I knew you would laugh. It's true, all the same.
I didn't know you were so vain, Basil. I see very little of you in this. He is a narcissus, and you have an intellectual expression. But beauty, real beauty, ends where an intellectual expression begins. Don't flatter yourself, Basil. You're not in the least like him.
Oh, I should be sorry to look like him. The ugly and the stupid have it best in this world. If they know nothing of victory, they're spared the knowledge of defeat.
What do you know of defeat?
Your rank and wealth, and my brains, and my art, whatever they may be worth. Dorian Gray's good looks. We shall all suffer for what the gods have given us.
Dorian Gray? Is that his name?
I didn't intend to tell you his name. When I like people immensely, I never tell their names to anyone. It's like surrendering a part of them. When I leave town, I never tell my people. I've grown to love secrecy. Is that foolish?
You forget I'm married. And the one charm of marriage is that it makes a life of deception absolutely necessary for both parties. When we meet, my wife and I, we tell each other the most absurd stories with the most serious faces. My wife is so much better than I am, she never gets confused over the dates, and I always do.
I believe you're a much better husband than you pretend to be. You never say a moral thing, and you never do a wrong thing. Your cynicism is a pose.
Being natural is a pose, the most irritating I know. Tell me truly why you refuse to exhibit his portrait.
It's hard for me to say. It sounds so incredible.
Then I should believe you at once.
I think... 2 months ago, I was at a crush at Lady Brandon's. You know how artists have to remind the public from time to time that we're not savages. That's where I saw him, at Lady Brandon's.
A peacock in everything but beauty.
She insisted we met.
She treats guests as an auctioneer treats his goods. The poor woman so wanted to find a salon, and she only succeeded in opening a restaurant.
Harry, you have no idea of friendship.
Unjust. I choose my friends for their good looks, my acquaintances for their good characters, and my enemies for their good intellects. A man cannot be too careful in the choice of his enemies.
So I must be merely an acquaintance?
Much more.
Less than a friend? A sort of brother?
I don't care for brothers. My elder brother won't die, and my younger brother seems to do nothing else.
Harry, I don't believe a single word.
Tell me more about Dorian Gray. How often do you see him?
I couldn't be happy if I didn't see him every day.
Extraordinary. I never thought you'd care for anything but your art.
He is all my art to me now. I can recreate life in a way that was hidden from me before, if he sits beside me.
I must meet Dorian Gray. I insist.
Harry, I find in him all the loveliness and subtleties of colour and line. I cannot exhibit his portrait because I have put into it some expression of this idolatry.
Idolatry?
There is too much of myself in it. I cannot bear my soul to the world's eyes. I cannot.
Is Dorian Gray fond of you?
Why should he visit me if he were not?
Come, Basil. Days in summer are apt to linger. There will come a day when you will be perfectly cold and indifferent when he calls, or he will be cold and indifferent to you.
He likes me, I know. But sometimes he seems to take delight in giving me pain, as if my soul were a flower to put in his coat, an ornament for a summer's day.
I want to meet him.
I don't want you to.
Mr. Dorian Gray, sir. Are you at home?
Fate, Basil. So gloriously predictable. We are both at home, Parker.
Dorian Gray is my dearest friend. He has a simple and beautiful nature. Don't spoil him. Don't influence him. The world has many marvellous people in it. Don't take away from me the one person who gives my art whatever charm it possesses.
Basil. Oh, I beg your pardon. I didn't know you had anyone with you.
Mr. Gray. Dorian Gray. Lord Henry Wotton.
He was all his portrait promised. And it was plain to see that poor Basil already bored him.
Oh. You must let me the music, Basil. I want to learn it.
That depends on how you sit today, Dorian.
You see, my lord, how easily I get into people's bad books. Not only Basil here, but Lady Agatha's too.
I'll make your peace with my aunt. She is quite devoted to you. She has told me so.
I promised to go to a club in Whitechapel with her last Tuesday and quite forgot. We were to play a duet together. Three duets.
It won't have mattered. When Aunt Agatha sits down to the piano, she makes quite enough noise for two.
That is very horrid to her, and not very nice to me.
You're too charming to go in for philanthropy, Mr. Gray. Far too charming. Will you smoke?
Harry, I want to finish this picture today. Would you think it rude of me to ask you to go away?
Am I to go, Mr. Gray?
Please don't. Basil is in one of his sulky moods, and I can't bear him then. If Lord Henry goes, then I shall go too. It is horribly dull standing on a platform trying to look pleasant.
Basil, you've often told me that you liked sitters to have someone to chat to.
Since Dorian wishes it, of course you must stay. And remember that Lord Henry has a bad influence over all his friends.
All his friends, Basil?
The single exception of myself.
Is that true, Lord Henry? Are you a bad influence?
There is no such thing as a good influence. Fear, shame, terror. These are the forces that drive mankind. The terror of society is the basis of morals. And the terror of God is the secret of religion. It is in the brain only that the great sins of the world take place. You, Mr. Gray, with your rose-red youth and your rose-white boyhood, have had passions that made you afraid, thoughts that have filled you with terror.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.